Thank you very much for the invitation. So my talk will mainly be about human history using ancient DNA. So over the last 10 years, my group has focused on trying to understand how we as anatomically modern humans have obtained our genetic diversity and geographical distribution in the world. And the main tool to do this that we have been using is ancient human genomics. We did the first ancient human genome in 2010, and after that, because of improved methods, and it's also become cheaper to sequence, you know, we sequenced the ancient human genomes all over the world, and from going from studies where we just did a single genome and analyzed it, now we're in a situation where we can do basically 100 of ancient genomes and doing real past population genetic studies. So one of the areas that my group has been particularly interested in is the early peopling of the Americas. So in terms of the American continents are generally believed to be the last to be populated by humans, and therefore if we can't understand what was going on there, I think we have very little hope to understand what has been going on in the rest of the world where there's a much deeper time history. Nevertheless, it still remains one of the most debated areas, both in terms of when did humans arrive, where did they come from, and what is the relationship of the first humans in America to present-day Native American populations. There's also a huge debate in terms of what routes humans took to enter the continent. The kind of school book example is that they went into Alaska around 14,000 years ago, but the way to the lower 48 states in South America were blocked by two massive ice caps lying across North America, and first when those melted back, an interior ice-free corridor was formed and humans could move through there. But and creating the so-called Clovis complex around 13,000 years ago with these big spear points that they presumably were using to hunt mammoth and other big game animals. But other people have argued, you know, people came in way earlier bypassing the ice caps by going along the west coast of North America. There's also people have been arguing that the first humans in America are not the direct ancestors of present-day Native Americans, but rather peoples from Europe, or peoples related to Aborigine Australians and so forth. So back in 2014, we sequenced the first ancient human genome from America. It's a skeleton, the only skeleton, in fact, that has been found in direct association with the so-called Clovis complex or Clovis technology. And this is very important because all the different theories have a prediction of who Clovis should be. Should it be some kind of Europeans? Should it be some kind of Aborigine Australians or Native Americans and so forth? And what we could see was that this individual, which is around 600 years old, is genetically speaking basically a Native American. And the critics, when we put out this, obviously created a lot of, you can say, debate, and because it was a major blow to all these theories that claimed that there has been other people in the Americas prior to the ancestors of Native Americans. But one of the criticisms was that it's only one skeleton, and America is obviously very big, and what about the rest of America? And there, the second genome we did from North America was very crucial. I think it's that of the Kennewick man that also some of you might know. I mean, it's probably the most famous skeleton in America. It resulted in a 10-year-long court case between archaeologists and anthropologists on one side and Native Americans and the U.S. government on the other side, because anthropologists claimed it's not a Native American, it's actually an individual based on cranial morphology that are related to either Europeans or Japanese Ainu, which is the indigenous population of Japan. But also here we could see, genetically speaking, this is a Native American, there's no more European or Ainu, if you want, relationships to Kennewick man than there is to contemporary Native Americans. We also more recently did a skeleton up from Alaska, which is not the oldest, it's around 11,000, but it turned out very excitingly to be, you can say, the earliest branch that we know of Native Americans that diversified around 20, 1,000 years ago relative to the other Native Americans living or extinct, if you want, that we know of genetically. And that, of course, put some support to the idea, well, that Alaska was, in fact, the entrance route of the early Americans, and also, I think, put some, you can say, some evidence that people came into the Americas probably way earlier than what we have generally thought based on archaeology, namely 14,000 years ago, because we have that skeleton in Alaska, and it splits off from everybody else around 21,000 years ago. More recently, we have done skeletons, ancient skeletons, ranging from around 10,000 to 11,000, all the way from Alaska, all the way down to Brazil. And what is quite interesting is that although these early skeletons obviously associated with very different cultures, and they have a very big geographical spread, they're genetically extremely similar to each other. And what it really shows us is that the spread by which these early people took was very fast. Probably within a few hundred years, they were on both the sides of the Rocky Mountains after they came down from Alaska and all the way down to South America, and that they also adapted culturally to the different environments extremely fast. Everything from high desert to the plains to kind of tropical climate. So you can say the whole notion that I was raised with, that human movement is due to a matter of resources, right? That people will stay in the same place until they explore the resources and first then they will be moving on, doesn't seem to fit. I mean, people have been driven by something else, probably curiosity, just like we are doing it today, right? Why would people go to the Mount Everest, for example, right? It's probably kind of the same thing driving these peoples. And as you also probably know, I mean, this type of genetic work is extremely sensitive, particularly in North America. So my group, we're spending a lot of time engaging with the communities that you can say associated geographically or culturally with these ancient human remains. But in general, I think our work has been well received, not at least because it has resulted in many of these skeletons being repatriated to the tribes. And for the many tribes, this is extremely important that they get their ancestors back. So it have given me a number of very good friends among Native Americans. On the other hand, it has also resulted in a lot of enemies among anthropologists and archaeologists, but I guess you can't be good friends with everybody, you know. So where's Native Americans coming from? I mean, this has been kind of a mystery because, of course, we believe as scientists that they are coming somewhere from Asia, but there's really been no group, contemporary group, if you want, that genetically are very closely related to Native Americans. But we got a glimpse into that story when we sequenced a 24,000-year-old skeleton from around Lake Baikal, called the Maltar, and this individual turned out, strangely enough, to be related to, very closely related to Native Americans, but also related to Northern Europeans, and not really closely related to, you can say, people of East Asian ancestry, which is traditionally the way we have been looking scientifically at Native Americans, that it's some kind of Asian group moving in, getting isolated, moving into the Americas. And first of all, this is an area today occupied, you can say, with people of different Mongolian groups that would be determined indigenous to the region. So it was one of the first examples we saw where we could see, well, when you go back into the past, people have had a very different distribution, right? But a following up study that we published last year, I believe, shows kind of why, you know, Siberians today, although they are the closest to Native Americans, genetically speaking, are actually quite distinct because there's been multiple waves of humans moving into northeastern Siberia. So this group, you can say, of these Maltar-like peoples basically were the first peoples that we know of, at least, that occupied these areas. But later on, other groups of, you can say, people of East Asian ancestry moved into these regions, and the second wave, which is basically the majority of Native American genetic ancestry is coming from, mix up with this first group. So around two-thirds of Native American ancestry is coming from the second wave, while one-third is coming from this group of Maltar people that we don't see as a group of people today. We haven't seen them. I will talk a little bit about their faith later on in the talk. And then finally, there's a third group around 10,000 years moving up and basically replacing most of the people that we know of in northeastern Siberia. And that's, but at that point, you can say Native American ancestors have already moved into the Americas and therefore are not infected by this wave. So what route did these people take when they first came into Alaska that was ice-free? How did they bypass these ice caps? In order to address this question, we used environmental DNA, which is something we discovered during my PhD. It's that you can take the DNA directly from ancient sediments, even in the absence of macrofossils, and you can basically retrieve the DNA of the mammals, the birds, the plants that were living in this area at the time when this soil was part of the surface. So we went into the interior ice-free corridor, or the part that had been the interior ice-free corridor, and went into lakes that were also believed to have been lakes at that time. And basically drilling lake cores, sediment cores, we went through the ice, through the water column, into the sediments, and then we could date macrofossils, and then we could basically shotgun sequence what was in these cores. And interestingly enough, we can follow the whole succession, biological succession of the interior ice-free corridor. So when it opens around 13,000 years ago, what we can see in the beginning is we see nothing really that people can live from. I mean, there's bacteria, there's fungi, but there's not a real, you can say, a biological community of plants and animals. Then after a few hundred years, we start seeing steppe environment with grasses, sedges, DNA from woolly mammoth, bison, and after a few more thousand years, it turns into open land forest. The animal life is changed into things like elk, and then after a few more thousand years, it gets into boreal forest, as we know in the region today, and the animal life turns into things like moose. And the conclusion here is we find it very unlikely that the interior ice-free corridor has been the route of the first peoples, because at the time where we for sure know that there's people south of the ice caps, there really doesn't seem to be anything to live from in there. And it's a journey of 1,500 kilometers, right? With ice on both sides. I mean, you need something to eat. You can't do that in one day's travel. So when did people then get in there? Well, the only way you can really address this is through archaeology. I mean, archaeological sites, but we can help with it. And this is what we did when we did the Paisley Caves. So in the Paisley Caves in southern central Oregon, there's no skeleton remains. There's nothing really older being found in America that has been securely dated in terms of skeleton remains older than the Clovis skeleton I talked about previously. But in the Paisley Caves, there's feces samples, ancient feces samples, and we can extract the DNA of these ancient feces samples, and we can date them, and some of them turned actually out to be human. And therefore, you know, and the age of these were a little more than 14,000 years old. So that's at least 1,000 years older than the oldest evidence of Clovis. So it's pretty clear that humans have been present in North America, and there's also evidence by others from South America prior to Clovis. How much earlier is still heavily debated. I would say this study, when we put it out first, the first paper in 2008, has been the paper I've got most criticized for. I mean, at that time, the majority archaeologists in America believed in Clovis first, that Clovis were the first people. And one of the main criticisms was, you know, you haven't found any tools. I mean, I'm not an archaeologist, but I can't see why you would bring tools to your toilet. I don't bring my knife and fork with me to the toilet, but apparently that's what some archaeologists does. But the poor archaeologist that involved in this study, Dennis Jenkins, was then digging and digging and digging, and finally he found two broken tools. And interesting enough, they were found in the same age layer as Clovis, but it wasn't Clovis tools. It was something called Western stem point. So that was also a major blow to the Clovis first idea, because according to that idea, everything, both the humans and the culture, should derive from Clovis, everything coming. And suddenly there was actually a totally other type of toolkit than Clovis. So what was the impossible impact of these early peoples in northeastern Siberia in America? Well, some researchers are arguing you can say it's really the first major human impact on the environment, because they killed off the megafauna, the big bodied ice age mammals that were super diverse and were living there until around 10, 11,000 years ago, such as woolly mammoth. We have tried to investigate this as well, because the alternative idea is that it was some kind of climatic changes that caused this mass extinction. And it is a mass extinction. About 2/3 of the big bodied mammal genera were actually lost in this period of time. In order to address this, we did population genetic studies on a number of these, you can say, animals, six of these animals, coupled with climate niche modeling, which is basically predictions of what would the niche have been if you only use temperature and precipitation as measurements for basically predicting the niche of the animals. And interestingly enough, we can see a statistical correlation between changes in effective population size of these animals and the changes in the climate niches. And this suggests that climate has been a major driver. And in fact, for some of the animals, there's no humans around in those areas where, at the time when they're going extinct, such as muskox, for example. And we followed up this study by looking at how be driving to cause this extinction. So we did environmental DNA studies on more than 200 permafrost cores across the Northern Hemisphere, extracting the DNA from the plants, communities. And what we can see is that the diversity and composition of plants is changing dramatically over the last 50,000 years. So it starts being very diverse between 50 and 30,000, then during the last glacial maximum, where it's very cold and dry, you know, the diversity goes down, but it's still a subset of the original diversity, which is very dominated by nutrient-rich forbs. But then when it's getting warm again, maybe as I naively thought, well, then you would just return to the same vegetation composition as previously, before it became cold. But in fact, it becomes totally different and becomes dominated by shrubs and grasses. And then when you look at the stomach content of these megafauna animals, sometimes you find them as mummies, particularly in Siberia, and you can go in and you can take samples of the stomach content and sequence that. It seems like they are, you know, the food is very much dominated by these very nutrient-rich forbs, and those are massively declining, you know, when we get into the Holocene, around 11,000 years ago. So the most, I would say, straightforward interpretation at least is that the climate is driving the changes in plant composition that is basically driving the extinction. I'm not saying that humans couldn't take out some of these driddled populations, but I don't think we see evidence that it's the main driver of the extinction. What about the rest of the world? What about Europe? What is the story there? Well, until we could do genomics, we had very little knowledge of who were these early modern humans in Europe, who were they related to. So we sequenced the first ancient early Stone Age human genome from Europe. It's called the Kuczynski 14. It's dated between 36 and 38,000 years old. And based on skull morphology, again, people have claimed it somehow could be related to Aborigine Australians. We don't see that at all genetically. I mean, this, interestingly enough, this individual, I mean, it doesn't seem to be direct ancestral to any people that we have sequenced today, but it's more closely related to contemporary people from Europe and Western Asia than it is to anybody else. So it do suggest that there has been quite a long-term continuity within Europe, some degree of that. We see some major changes in Europe happening from the transition from hunter-gathering to farming, which takes place between 11,000 and 6,000 years ago in Europe. And this is really the first major change we see in the genetic composition. And so it's, you know, when I was growing up in school, I learned, Eske, you are deriving directly from the Stone Age man in Denmark. And it was first in the 1960s when the Turks were coming to have work in Denmark, where we got a real immigration. You know, the rest was just the same people learning something new. And it's pretty clear it's totally wrong. I mean, So the change from the first change, this from you can say hunter-gathering to agriculture, is basically due to a migration of peoples from the Middle East and the Near East going up through Europe, where they in Southern Europe are mixing heavily with the local hunter-gatherers to the extent that today Southern Europeans look very much genetically similar to these early farmers, while when they get up to, you can say, Scandinavia, you know, they still mix not as much, and when they get to Northeastern Europe, they just deliver, you know, the hay and the cow and whatever they have and say, this is how you do it, but we don't want to mix with you. So this is where you can say you find people who are most closely related to the original hunter-gatherers that occupied Europe. This you can say, this transition from hunter-gathering to farming is probably the biggest lifestyle transition we have experienced as modern humans. I mean, it's we are going from a, you can say, a very mobile lifestyle, very small communities to larger communities, a sedentary lifestyle, and our food is also completely changing, right? We're going from eating fish and meat, berries and nuts, to basically eating something similar to muesli day out and day in. And we can see this is really genetically impacting us. I mean, we have selection on things that are involved, for example, of changing short-chain fatty acids into long-chain fatty acids that we need for our brain and our nervous system. So when you eat meat and fish, you're getting long-chain fatty acids directly, but when you're eating muesli, you're getting it as short-chain fatty acids, and you have to turn it into long-chain fatty acids. And this is done, among other things, with the fats rich in the genome, and we see massive selection there. So this is really something that has impacted us. And when you look at things like lifestyle diseases across the world's population today, I mean, you could start speculating because we, most of us today, are living, a lifestyle which is an advanced lifestyle of the early farmers, basically, right? High carbohydrate foods. And when you look at this distribution of the diseases, I do wonder whether it actually reflects when did people undergo this transition from hunter-gatherer to farmer, right? Because when it happens thousands of years ago in Europe, for example, there was time for some kind of adaptation. It's not perfect, but there's time for some kind of adaptation. In other communities where it's happened, you know, within the last 200, 300 years, they haven't had that time to genetically adapt in the same way. So it's not over with migrations in Europe from this transition from hunter-gathering to farming. We've just become farmers, we get into the Bronze Age, and again there's been a discussion, what made that change? And we can see genetically, again, it's due to some massive influx of people. This time it's a group of people, they are pastoralists called Yamnaya, we call them Yamnaya, from the Pontic steppe, moving 5,000 years ago into Northwestern Europe and also eastwards into Western and Central Asia. And when we saw this picture of this divergence going east and northwest, we got very excited because this goes into the debate of the origin of the Indo-European languages, which is the most commonly spoken language family today. This is English, Danish, and so forth. And of course, linguists have been interested to understand how did we have an early spread of this very diverse and very widespread language family. And there's many different theories out there about when does it originate, where does it originate. But one of them, the steppe hypothesis, is basically predicted exactly such a spread from the Pontic steppe around 5,000 years ago. And in Europe, you can say these Yamnaya people, Northwestern Europe, seems to have a really significant genetic impact. So the gray spots are contemporary European genetic diversity. And first you see that the hunter-gatherers are actually falling outside this genetic diversity we see today. The same is the case to a large extent for the early farmers. It's really first in the Bronze Age, from around 5,000 years ago, that the contemporary genetic landscape of Europe starts being created. So it's extremely late in our history. So Yamnaya seems to really be the contributor. The genetics fits with the idea that Yamnaya probably are the contributor of the Indo-European languages into Europe, because they seem to have a very big genetic impact. What about Asia? Well, the story in Asia, surprisingly, is very different. So we didn't know who were the people in Western and Central Asia prior to Yamnaya arrival around 5,000 years ago. And when we sequenced them, we got very surprised, because it turns out that it's actually the descendants of these Maltar people that I talked about that gave rise, among other things, to Native Americans genetically. We thought they died out, you know, in early Stone Age, around 20,000 years ago, but in fact, some of them survived in Western and Central Asia until just a few thousand years ago. And surprisingly enough, these guys are also the ones that are the first to domesticate the horse that we know of. It's a site called Botai in Kazakhstan, around 6,000 years old. It's the earliest clear evidence of horse domestication. You find marks of bristles in the teeth. You find milk residues in the pots. And you know, archaeologists have argued, oh, these peoples who are living a very simple lifestyle, mainly through hunter-gathering, they can't have done something important as domesticating the horse, which is one of the most important cultural events in human history. It's changed everything, right? How we do warfare, how we trade, the distances we can cover, etc. But in fact, we see no evidence of gene flow between the Botai and the Yamnaya. It seems like these Botai people have actually been domesticating locally this horse. They're horse hunters, and at some point they managed domesticating it. And Ludovico Lando's group have shown by sequencing the horses that these people made one of the biggest discoveries, if you want, cultural discoveries in human history. But the horses, the domestic horses we see today, are not deriving from this domestication event. So they did it, but they didn't manage to kind of spread the news, commercialize it, unfortunately. And somebody else did it independently and became the great success of horse domestication. It's terrible, it's kind of tragic irony. In the end of the Bronze Age, we also see another massive migration, and this time it's out of Europe and the Ural Mountains going eastwards. And these people, we call them many different names in different places, but very often they're called Centasta. And these are the first we know of that invented the chariot, which is the one you can from Ben-Hur, from the Ben-Hur movie, right? And they have one riding the chariot, and then there's a guy next to the rider, or the guy running the chariot, who has a bow and arrow. And this is an incredible, efficient war machine coming out of Europe and the Ural Mountains, spreading all the way to northern India and Pakistan. And on the way, they seem to erase really a lot of the original inhabitants of Western and Central Asia, because after the Centasta around 2,000 years ago, we don't see these Maltar people anymore. So you can say, well, they basically seem to be run over by these Centasta. What happens then into this massive steppe area, which also occurring the Silk Route that becomes so important for trade between Asia and Europe? What is happening after the Bronze Age? Well, the next people or culture that is really dominating in this area is the Scythians. These are mounted warriors, both women and men are warriors. And there's been a lot of discussion about where are the Scythians deriving from? Because culturally, they're covering a huge area, and they are, culturally extremely similar. Interestingly enough, it's a multi-ethnic group. Some of them seems to be the descendants of the Centasta. Others are coming down from the Siberian forests and are of East Asian descent and basically taking up this lifestyle. And even though the culture is very similar, there seems to be very little, if any, genetic exchanges between them. So this is an example, you can say, of spread of culture without necessarily, people having sex, if you want, and children together. After that, we get into, the historical period with the Huns. And again, the Huns will occupy, this whole region. They're horsemen. It's also been heavily debated from where are the Huns deriving from. And genetically, it's very clear they're coming out of China. And these are Turkic-speaking people. I mean, when we started this project, I'm not a historian or an archaeologist, I naively thought, well, the Turkish language must originate in Turkey. Well, that's not the case. Turks are basically Middle Eastern people that have adapted, you can say, the Turkish language. It's coming out with these Huns. And the Huns, we can see, of course, have a very wide distribution, but they leave very limited genetic legacy. So it seems to be one of these rulers that are sitting on the top right, but have no much interaction with the people that they're dominating. But what they do have is a massive linguistic impact. So it basically, they're changing this big area from being mainly Indo-Iranian speakers to becoming Turkish speakers. But genetically, they don't seem to have a big impact. This is opposite the next wave of people, which is the Mongols, with Genghis Khan, the Golden Horde, and so forth. These peoples are basically genetically transforming most of Western and Central Asia from being genetically of Western Eurasian ancestry, it means people related to what we see today of people in Europe, to becoming peoples that genetically are of East Asian ancestry. So you can say, as we see it today in these regions. So again, just like Europe, you can say the genetic landscape, if you want, is shaped very, very late in our history, right? What about Australia? Well, Australia is a very different story. So we did the first Aboriginal Australian genome back in 2011, and there has been a lot of debate of what are Aboriginal Australians, who are they related to? Some have argued they're actually, you can say, closely related to people of East Asian genetic ancestry. Others have argued it's a much earlier migration out of Africa. What we see is so far is that it seems to be the same out of Africa event as other non-Africans, but they seem to be diversifying 20 to 30,000 years before people of Western Eurasian and East Asian ancestry are diversifying from each other around 50,000 years ago. So you can say, I normally say, they seem to be descending from the earliest modern human explorers that are still have descendants today. And they have this remarkable journey where they're crossing Asia, basically crossing the ocean into Australia and Papua that at that time were connected to each other. So both, you can say, Highland Papuans and Aboriginal Australians seems to be part of this wave. And it's so far back in time, they're crossing probably around 60,000 years ago. So when you look genetically at Aboriginal Australians and Highland Papuans, they're genetically basically as distinct from each other as is people of East Asian and European ancestry today. And even within Australia, northeastern Australia and southwestern Australia is more divergent from each other than are Siberians from Native Americans. And again, this is a very delicate issue in Australia. I mean, Aboriginal Australians, I would say I've seen, visit many indigenous groups around the world, and I would say I have never seen, or heard about a story of how indigenous people were treated as heartbreaking as that of Aboriginal Australians, and that's also by scientists. So therefore, I mean, they are, for good reasons, very skeptical. But, I made great relationships with these peoples, and today we have a big diabetes association study going with a number of these groups. And this, you can say, this wave, if you want, this early wave of modern humans also goes into the peopling of Southeast Asia. So in Southeast Asia, you have pockets of people who are looking very distinct from other Southeast Asians, such on the Andaman Islands, for example, and where it has been a mystery, where are these people coming from? It really seems genetically that they're part of the same expansion, you can say early expansion. And we can see that when we go back just 5,000 years in Southeast Asia, these groups that we now see on the Andaman Islands isolated were basically distributed across mainland Southeast Asia, all over the place. But around 5,000 years ago, there's movements of people coming, starting from China and from Taiwan, going into Southeast Asia, and they are bringing with them agriculture, rice. And there's been theories about that they were replaced, you know, killed off by these such people, but this is not what we see. What happens is basically they're mixing up with each other. So you can say most Southeast Asian populations today is actually a mixture between these very early peoples occupying Southeast Asia now on the Andaman Islands and groups coming down from China and mainland China and Taiwan. So we also look into adaptations of you can say some of these people. So one of these indigenous populations are called Banjo, and they are living almost their entire life on the sea or in the sea, diving. And basically, if they go on land, they become seasick. And it's been known for a long time that they have incredible skills in terms of diving, right? They can be, hold the breath very long. They don't need any iron to basically go and walk on the bottom and so forth. But it has been debated whether it was physiological, poorly physiological adaptations, or whether it was genetic adaptations as well. And this lifestyle is believed not to be very old, about a few thousand years old. So, therefore, people thought, well, there can't be genetic adaptations. But when we looked at this, my PhD student, Melissa, was both doing a screening of the spleen size, because the spleen is the reservoir of red blood cells that you obviously need when you get into hypoxia when you're diving, right? And the spleen size of these guys is basically about 50% larger than the relatives on land. And genetically, when we look, we sequence some of these guys and look for selection, there's very strong selection in the region of the genome that are involved in the spleen size, but also in the diving response. The diving response is something we all have when we get cold water into our face. You know, our vessels will retract and the spleen will pump out red blood cells. So it's clearly that over a very short period of time, apparently, these peoples have genetically adapted to this lifestyle. And it's also relevant to the rest of us, because hypoxia is, I'm not a medical doctor, but I learned afterwards that hypoxia is something we should be very concerned about. If we go into surgery, for example, people can actually die from hypoxia. So therefore, obviously, it's very important to know what variants are involved in hypoxia. And this is one way to get such information, going to these groups that are living under very extreme conditions. Finally, I want to talk about what is driving these migrations that we discussed. And I'm sure there's many reasons for people migrating. I don't think you can find one common cause. But one thing we got very surprised about is that pathogens, epidemics, seems to have played a role way earlier than what we thought. So we thought traditional that epidemics is something that happens late in history when people are living in cities, big, larger cities where you can get incorporated, and also spread from these cities different types of pathogenic diseases. To our big surprise, when we were sequencing the teeth of these Bronze Age individuals in Europe and Western Asia, we could also see that from the teeth, we not only got the human genome, but we also got the genome of some of the pathogens. The reason why we started looking after it was because of these extreme population dynamics, particularly in Western Asia, where one group is replacing another very fast, at least locally. Within a few thousand years, several groups have replaced each other, and we start wondering, what is the driver of this? This is crazy. Was it climate change? We couldn't really see any massive things happening climatically. And then an archaeologist, Christian Christiansen, said, well, what about epidemics? And the only epidemic we had heard about, because we're not medical doctors, was plague, right? I mean, we all heard about that, the Black Death and things. So we started trying to look in all the waste products that we sequence, which is the majority of the DNA we're getting out. Maybe just a few percent of it is actually ancient human DNA. The rest is microbes. And we thought, well, this is microbes that has penetrated the teeth and bone post-mortem. But in fact, it turned out that about 10% of the individuals, of these Bronze Age individuals, we found pestis, which is basically causing plague. And we can even see an evolution through the Bronze Age. So it starts with the version that is spread directly from human to human through saliva and blood that was believed to be, you can say, the derived version, but this didn't turn out to be the case. It's first in the end of the Bronze Age that we see that the pestis bacteria is getting the YMT region, which allows it to survive in the flea gut and now can be spread through fleas, okay? But way earlier, 3,000 years earlier than any written records of plague. And of course, we got really excited about this and we start looking for plague and other diseases. And to our surprises, we even found evidence of plague earlier than 5,000 years in the late Neolithic peoples, okay? So we found evidence, it's still not in a lot of individuals, but we find it there. And now, therefore, we can, interesting enough, if you look at the rate of mutation and the divergent stage in the plague, it actually changes when you incorporate the ancient plague genomes. So it's really clear that when you try to look at phylogenies and if you want to look at mutation rates, you can't just do that from contemporary strains. And you know, the interesting part is that the emergence of plague, when we put in the ancient ones, is close to around just before 5,000 years ago. And this is where the archaeologists for years have seen that there is a massive drop in the population size of these farmers. They're doing really well. They're coming in, basically taking over, right? And living and spreading and just increasing in numbers. And then, you know, suddenly they're just crashing. And this is around the time where we find evidence molecularly of the emergence of plague. And we see it in some of the individuals, right? So I think it's reasonable to at least have the hypothesis that plague could have been the driver of this. We also found plague that I think is interesting in regard to the Justinian plague, which is way later, but killed off massive amounts of peoples in Europe. Because we found, a plague strain, which is just basal to Justinian plagues in some of the Huns. And I'm not claiming that the Huns brought in the Justinian plague. What I'm saying is that it seems, I think, reasonable to hypothesize that the Justinian plague came from the steppe, because this is where we find the most basal version of it. It's too early for being the Justinian plague when it gets into Europe, but I think it's likely that it came from this steppe area. Of course, after we saw the plague results, we got all excited, and now we start looking for all kinds of pathogens in these early individuals. And you know, I had this romantic idea when I started this about, you know, these really clean early hunter-gatherers, farmers, Bronze Age women, and all kinds of stuff. I mean, these guys are just massively infected with all kinds of stuff. So I mean, it's not nice. And one of the things we see, which also with surprising results, is in hepatitis B. Hepatitis B is still a disease opposite plague. There's still people being infected with plague today in US and in China, for example, but it's not like a massive problem, right? But hepatitis B is actually something that millions of people are infected with, this 100,000 dying from hepatitis B. And there has been argued in the literature that hepatitis B was coming from America and have only been in Europe for around 500-600 years. We find it back in Europe almost 5,000 years ago, okay? So it's a very different story. Some of the genotypes we found is also found today, but others are new. We don't see them today at all. And this, I think, is one thing which is really exciting about this pathogen work, because this is a general trend we see, that when you go back in time, just a few thousand years, the diversity is actually much larger than today. And my colleagues who are, you know, into epidemics says, when you have had a successful, you can say, mutation in the past, it's just a matter of time before it will reappear. So in fact, what these ancient strains are giving us is a catalog over the possibility mutation routes that these pathogens could take. And it gives us an opportunity to also, you know, resurrect them, look at the impact of them in mice, for example, and also see present-day vaccines, do they actually cover some of what will hit us possibly in the future, right? And even also the distribution is very different in the just the recent past. So some genotypes that we only see in northern India today is outside India when you go back to the Bronze Age. And some of this is related, you can say, to of course these movements of peoples that I talked about previously. Okay, I'll just end up by saying something about, well, how far back in time can we go with all this genetic research? Well, together with Ludovico Lando, we did the oldest, I believe is still the oldest ancient genome to date, which is from a horse from Alaska, which is 700,000 years old. But this is also a unique area in terms of preservation, right? It's permafrost, it's not that cold, it's just minus 1-2 degrees, something like that, but still is unique. Most parts of the world, of course, you don't have that type of preservation. And you can't really go into genomics to the extent we did here. And there, I think, one new thing I think is super exciting is these ancient proteins. Proteins are much more stable than DNA and survive in much poorer environments over longer time. We have known that for a number of years. But until recently, you can say the proteins we could get out of these materials were collagen. And collagen, there's very little variation between, there's almost basically no variation between closely related species, right? So Neanderthals and modern humans, for example, it has the same, there's one, I think, difference to chimps. But there, Enrico Capellini recently showed, you know, that dentin in the teeth, and teeth is what you find in most, you can say, excavations. This dentin protein, there's actually a quite substantial variation even between closely related species. And we used it to address questions about the phylogeny of rhinos, you know, from a site of, I believe is more than 1 million years old for sure. And this, of course, can open up a complete new area to understand also the relationship between acaric humans, for example, Homo erectus, and other antecessor and modern humans and so forth. So there's, for the people who might be interested in this, there's a number of recent review papers on the area. And then I would just like to thank all the colleagues from my group and our collaborators and our people who have supported us financially to undertake this work. Thank you very much for your time.